Now I'll show you a few designs for the characters. So you can see very clean lines, very watertight colors. The colors don't bleed into other areas. And these are what these are called model sheets. These are created for each character. Now this shows them in different moods. So when they're angry, when they're sad, when they're happy, the model sheets are created to create their body language in the movie. These are for the lead character. And this is for his father, her father. A few interaction between the city people and the forest people. These are the model sheets for the Wolfwalker character. So again, you can see very, very aggressive, very out of control. Some early concepts. And when they draw it the first time, that it not necessarily the exact same thing will be translated into the screen. The drawings evolve over a period of time. Model sheets, again. Models with color. These are called turnarounds. So they draw the character from every angle. And the animators use that as a reference when they are animating the characters from different angles. This is the mother character. Different expressions. This is called a turnaround. These are for the wolves. So even the animals, this is the first time that they were animating talking animals. So they didn't want to create animations which looked like realistic, because they wanted to stylize it and they were going to use. So they actually referred to Bambi for some of the animation for the animals, but then they exaggerated it. They called in an animal animation teacher. I follow his work online. And he actually taught them how to draw the animation for the characters. A lot of symbolism in the movie. This is the model sheets for the animals. So this is the bird character. Interaction with humans. This is the model sheet for the villain character. So again, when it comes to this is a very nice frame to show the difference from the villain character is very, very blocky to the forest. All the lines are flowing up and down. Nothing is going just horizontally or vertically. These are the town folk. Again, different postures, animals. Again, you'll see that the animals are very stylized. They are not; they don't look like normal animals. And there were also a number of symbols which were used. So these symbols, you don't directly see them. They are actually, like I keep saying again and again, a lot of symbolism. They are actually embedded in the environment. So you don't actually see them like face out, but you can see them in all the environment, like rocks and trees and whatnot, which, you know, sometimes they have used the effect of glow to highlight them in the story. And then they also came out with an art of book. So they released a book. Here are a few pages of the book. So those are all the designs that were done for the movie. Now coming to the next step, where how did they actually animate the characters? So I'll show you a clip. Philip, could you?
In terms of animation, was there a lot of research of wolf or dog behavior, or are the wolves sort of magical enough that we you just work with it whatever way you want? Do you want to take that, Tom?
Sure. Yeah, I guess it was a mixture, you know. We didn't want to be making a movie that was strictly naturalistic like Bambi or Balto or something like that. We wanted the wolves to embody a kind of a spirit of wildness. So some of the early development stuff we did with Federico Pervano, another one of the concept character designers, was really rough and really loose, and like every part of the wolf was just like almost like liquid. But then we realized that they needed to have some personality and they needed to be able to slow down and do other things. And that's when we went more towards anatomy of a real dog or wolf, and that's when we were lucky to have some studio dogs. People would bring in their dogs. Like two of the animators had a big wolf-like dog that we were able to look at, Hobbs, and things like that were helpful so that we could integrate some natural, realistic movement and behavior with the more fantastical vision that we had for a very expressive, loose approach.
Yeah, because they do, they move, they often move together as a mass looking almost kind of like liquid, which is something a little bit more fantastical. Or
That kind of came from early exploration with Federico, but then as the story evolved and as the animation evolved, we worked with loads of different artists who were more specifically focused on anatomically correct drawing of wolves and stuff. So we kind of blended both approaches.
Yeah, that great workshop with Aaron Blaze as
well. Oh yeah, Aaron Blaze was a fantastic character, animal character animator, and he did a workshop with us and he did some concepts, and even online we were able to follow along with him, and we learned a lot about wolf anatomy and animating four-legged animals from him. And also another master, James Baxter, was able to take a couple of scenes and do a workshop, a master class with us as well about four-legged animal animation. So that was, those were really helpful. There's like such Disney legends of animal animation. It was great for us to get that.
It's true, like with any of these things, you sort of think you know how a wolf or a dog looks, and once you start to work on the, even the skull shape is sort of not what you expect when you come to it.
Yeah, and the other thing I found was that we had never done talking animals before. You know, Panger and Koo and all the animals that we'd animated before, even the seals, they never spoke in their animal form. So it was the first time we had to try and say, well, do we go all the way to Mononoke where it's like telepathy, or do we use something a little bit more like Lady and the Tramp? So we kind of tried to find our own balance, you know.
Yeah, okay. And so, I mean, I'll open this to anyone, but there's a good question here from Twitter. What were you able to achieve on Wolfwalkers that you couldn't do before, especially any technical or craft things, and how these advances impacted the storytelling? I mean, certainly the first half. Were there things you felt you could do more just because of our experiences now, or anything come to mind?
One thing that we were able to do on this ahead of the others was use the line as an expression of the character's emotion, which I think we'd been playing around with it with a couple of like shorts or smaller projects, but never on a feature. So in the film, you can see when Maeve is angry that the lines boil off her, or hopping off her body. And then, like, you know, the townspeople who are all like caged and oppressed, they have like this ink block, like very heavy, very dominant, oppressive line. And then there's a whole gamut in between that. And even Robin, in between scenes, when she goes from wild to tame or vice versa, her cleanup line changes throughout just one scene, which was a huge ask of the cleanup department. But they're the kind of things that I think we couldn't have done in previous films. I think like through limitations of time and money, but also through limitations of like software as well.
And one thing that comes to mind when I read this question is I really loved how we were able to have this dialogue in a way between techniques that are hundreds of years apart. So the way that we were able to do the sort of offset look off the town, especially, that we were then able to use that to create smears and multiples in the animation. And that sort of allowed it to become part of our language. It was like this sort of dialogue between over across hundreds of years that happened there. So it wasn't just in the layouts, we were able to kind of let the ink and paint department sort of do that stuff as well there.
Yeah, it was a little bit tricky because for the town, the style was pretty clear from the scene illustrations. And for the forest, it was a little bit more messy, but it had to be messy because we wanted that freedom, that loose lines and everything. So at the beginning, every artist, when they were joining the final line team for backgrounds, they tend to do everything very detailed and very like making all the flowers perfect and everything. So at some point we did some workshops where we were seeing all the scene illustrations, and I was sometimes drawing some pieces of the background so they could see like, oh, it doesn't matter if you are just doing this and it's not perfect. And they were like, oh, okay. So at some point it was a little bit tricky. And I think it took like maybe a week for each artist, maybe sometimes more, to get used to the style, even for myself, because I used to tend to draw very, very clean. So I was surprised. But at some point, everyone was having that feeling of loose lines, especially for the forest. And yeah, they started to add less detail. And for some sequences, like the Running with the Wolves one, we tried to push that even more. And we were using like charcoal and like, you just do your lines very loose. Don't try twice. Whatever it comes the first time is better. So it was very funny, but it was tricky to make it all work together.
Okay.
Yeah. What do they mean by loose line?
Loose
lines?
Yeah. So, like I said earlier, that when they, so the thing that you saw here, there are various stages in which animation is drawn. So first, they only draw the keyframes. So there's an animator who will only draw the important frames, and then there will be an artist who will draw the in-between frames. And when they are drawing these, they actually just rough it out. They don't make very clean lines. And then there's a cleanup artist who will clean up those lines to make them clean.
In terms of animation, was there a lot of research of...
And then I have another question.
Yeah.
For example, like, okay, in many drawings like this.
Yeah.
Like you have, there is the line here, but the color actually is off.
No, that, when they draw color out of an object, they are actually trying to show motion.
Yeah, so basically like here, like you can see, for example, the head.
Yeah.
And the face is never shows this effect.
Yeah.
But like many, for example, the room here, you see it for the movement?
Yes. So this is called secondary animation. So what they have done is they actually kept their, usually this is used when we are animating cloth. Because when you animate cloth, your hand stops, but the cloth keeps moving for some time before it stops. So that's known as secondary animation. And in this case, since they wanted to speed up their time for production, they actually just painted outside to show that secondary movement. Okay, so that's the trick, yeah. Yeah, yeah. So those will, with big budget movies, those actually become more frames that they draw. And with movies which have smaller budget, they use these tricks to give a sense of movement, fast movement.
Yeah, it's what, 12 image per second, like half the...
No, 12 image per second is the minimum. If you have less than that, then it's very jaggy. But for a movie, it would be, film is 25. So they'll have 25 images per second. Okay, so they did refer to a movie called Bambi. I hope everybody has seen Bambi, yes? Is there any...
There were some positions of the girl or the wolf.
Yeah.
Which was Bambi-like.
Yes, so Bambi is a reference of very realistic animation of animals. Okay, and I hope there's nobody here who's not seen Bambi. If you have not seen it, please go and see it. Yeah, and the second thing I want to talk about is that they mentioned, I mean, if you want to find out who the person is, his name is Aaron Blaze. Aaron Blaze is an artist who is well known in the industry for animal animation. So if you want to find out about how animal animation is done, you can follow his work on YouTube. His name is Aaron Blaze. Moving on. Now I want to talk about one specific scene. There's a scene in the movie where the wolf vision, it's called the wolf vision scene. And they used a very particular technique, which is a new evolution of techniques following the 2D and the 3D animation. Okay, so I'll just play a video for you. And you'll get an idea about how they actually animated that specific fantasy.
This is 2D hand-drawn animation. And this is 3D computer-generated animation. But many films actually fall somewhere in between, or what's often referred to as 2.5D. This is when a variety of techniques are used to make an otherwise flat 2D film feel 3D, with depth, but also with a unique hand-drawn style. Animators might use illustration tricks like shading, layering, forced perspective, and parallax on 2D objects to make them appear as if they existed in a 3D space. Some films even mix dimensions by adding 3D characters and background objects to 2D films. Disney's Beauty and the Beast was primarily in 2D, but The Chandelier, a 3D CGI add-on. And animators created this jungle entirely in 3D, so a 2D hand-drawn Tarzan could swing through. Lion King was the same. This wildebeest stampede was digitally simulated in 3D, but Simba was in 2D. And animators are continuing to push 2.5D further, because there are still some things that computers can't fully replace, like the graphic look of comics in Into the Spider-Verse, which incorporated 2D line work on 3D models. The latest example of 2.5D innovation is Cartoon Saloon's 2020 film Wolfwalkers, which, like Tarzan, created a 3D forest. Only this 3D forest would never actually appear in the final film. A team of 9 animators would ultimately recreate every single digital frame of these scenes by hand on thousands of sheets of paper.
The idea was that it would not feel too clinical, too clean, too, like, artificial.
That's Evan McNamara, whom directors Tom Moore and Ross Stewart tasked with creating the Wolfvision scenes for the film. In these scenes, the viewer sees everything through the eyes of the main character, Robin, as she transforms into a wolf.
The main thing with the Wolfvision that Tom and Ross wanted to get on screen was they wanted to make it feel like a heightened perspective or a heightened experience, a heightened reality version of the film.
The animation team could have made a fully 3D film relying on digital technology, but they opted for 2D hand-drawn animation instead, specifically with graphite, to mimic art from the 1600s. But they decided to use 3D tools to first plan out the scenes. Using these tools and virtual reality in the pre-visualization stage helped create more realistic backdrops and mimic the natural movement of the wolf. There were 2 main settings in the film, the town and the forest, both with their own wolf vision scenes and art styles. The town, with its woodblock print, was easily made with more traditional 2.5D techniques. Animators worked in After Effects to place elements at various distances from the camera, creating an illusion of depth. This built on a technique that goes back to 1942, when Disney shot the opening scene of Bambi using a multiplane camera, which has layers of painted glass to achieve a similar parallax effect. But the forest previs scenes required a lot more innovation and a lot more work to get right. They were inspired by the look and feel of the Studio Ghibli film, The Tale of Princess Kaguya. So these scenes required a more organic stroke with a flowy watercolor style, a creative choice you couldn't really get with CGI. Evan started out with a simple hand-drawn sketch of the woods and a telescoping effect. He used depth maps and Photoshop to help create this illusion and sketch out the frames by hand, one by one. But he quickly realized they would need a more dynamic camera, because the wolf wouldn't just be walking forward. It would also be jumping, looking around, and even bobbing its head as it panted and breathed.
It helps you feel like you're actually in, you know, the head of the character.
So the team experimented with virtual reality using the headset Oculus Rift. They drew and built a 3D forest in VR with a sculpting program called Medium. This virtual set was then transferred to a computer animation tool Blender, where artists painted on more stylistic 2D elements. Animators used these rough overlays to adjust and refine the 3D model.
You would basically draw on top of the 3D models, bake in some line work onto the forms, but still give it a kind of a nice kind of squiggly and kind of hand-drawn feel.
Other 2D elements included soldiers and rough flames for the forest fire scene. That way, animators wouldn't have to guess locations for those assets later on. This 3D model was used to block out the path and speed of the camera movements.
And we would then start moving the camera through it, bring it to the directors, go, okay, well, how's the movement here? Is it looking good? They might go, actually, we should probably go a bit slower with this, so it has a bit more, like, oomph, or we should go faster, whatever the case may be.
Now, Disney used a similar method back in 1999, when animators created a 3D forest for a 2D Tarzan to swing through using a program called Deep Canvas. But they ultimately kept the 3D model and used digital paint in the final film. For Wolfwalkers, the audience never actually sees this 3D model or all the intricate design work involved in creating it. The final images were all eventually covered in handmade graphite drawings.
It's not just about concealing 3D, it's more about, like, how can we build on it and make it so it is primarily 2D.
Evan printed out each frame of his 3D sequence on paper using red ink as a guide. Then a team of 9 animators drew directly over each of these red images by hand with charcoal and pencil. The bright red could easily be removed later from the blacks and grays in the digital cleanup stage. Drawing each frame by hand is a time-consuming process, so to help manage the workload, they decided to halve the number of images by playing with the frame rate. Normally, you'd see 24 different images every second, but here they dropped down to 12. That way, they only had to draw 12 images for every second of the scene. But changing the frame rate can also make the scene appear choppy.
So we kind of compensated for that by smudging things and actually using the organic qualities. So it is just more like a drawing than it is like a camera movement.
Smudging was also used to create motion blur, like in this kitchen scene with the checkered floor. And the hand-drawn style allowed them to get creative with certain elements, like the smoke of the fire.
So the graphite would bleed out. It would go to the white of the page towards where the fire was. So you would get a nice kind of flickery feeling of the fire, like almost burning out the charcoal as such on the paper.
Once all of the drawings were complete, they scanned the approximate 6,000 hand-drawn images, digitally removed the red lines, and touched up the line work. They also added additional layers in the composite stage. As you can see here in this town scene, the various tones and textures and the colored wolf scent are all drawn separately. These multiple layers meant much more paper. For example, this scene, when Robin wakes up as a wolf for the first time, required about 1,500 printed pages. The result of all this hard work was an innovative 2.5D style that highlights the artist's skills in drawing by hand, something a computer alone wouldn't be able to do.
It's again just about getting an organic thing on screen that looks like people made it versus, you know, computer hit render.
That's a lot of information. Now, the thing is that one of the things that Philippe asked a little earlier, whether it was 12 or... So this is one of the cases in which they actually used 12 frames per second. And the reason they used it, because the animation, it makes it looks jagged. It's very jerky animation. That's the reason they used it in that scene. I can't dwell into every aspect of that. So if you have any questions regarding what you just saw, I can address them. Oh, everybody understood everything? What? There was a lot of information in there. Anyways, yeah. So moving on. So finally, once this film was created and bundled into a film, the movie was released in 2020 at the Toronto International Film Festival. Just like their other releases, this movie was also released in a film festival first. And then in this case, since we were in the pandemic era, this movie was released on a streaming service called Apple TV for broader audiences. And eventually it got released in US, Ireland, and all those, but it mostly had a digital release. And again, just like the other two movies, this movie was critically acclaimed. It got huge acclaim. There's a whole list, so majorly nominations for Oscars, Golden Globes, and BAFTA, and wins at Satellite and Annie Awards. They eventually also, on high demand, released a book with the same story. The difference between the movie and the book is that they have more story in the book. So they added a lot more stuff in the book which is not in the movie. That's an example of how the book looks like. And this book is also, you can order it online. So there are places where you can order this book. It's available at their own website and on the websites of the associations that they have. The other thing that happened is that this movie had such a big cultural influence that a government-funded gallery called Butler Gallery actually had an exhibition for this movie. For the artwork of this movie. Now, they could not have an actual exhibition where people could come because of the pandemic, but they actually created a virtual 3D, not a virtual 3D, the virtual physical, virtual reality, virtual physics. They actually did 360 photos of the gallery and uploaded, so we can actually show that. If you go to their website, just alt-tab, there's an actual virtual reality walkthrough. Just turn the camera. bring your, no, okay. Yeah, so you can just, you're here and you can actually turn to look around. So this is like a 360 look at the, and you can go from, this is the actual gallery. These are photographs of the gallery. And they are like, anybody here used Google Street View? So this is similar to that, same technology, where you can actually look around and go from one spot to another. So the entire gallery is present here. So you can move through the whole gallery in a virtual space. These are actual photographs. This is not created in 3D. And they also have annotations where you can click to read information about what you're looking at. Maybe we can move to some part, other part of the gallery. Okay. So it's like a walkthrough, the actual gallery, which is pretty intense. That you can actually walk through the gallery without being there. So this is something that Butler Gallery did. And I have an interview that I want to show you. If you could go back to the presentation. Yeah, this one.
The Butler Gallery was founded in 1943 by a group of volunteer Kilkenny people who were interested in culture and who wanted to organise exhibitions and begin to build a collection. Kilkenny County Council gave the Butler Gallery this Evans home, which was a former almshouse, to develop into a museum that would hold our collections. We now have a home that has galleries dedicated to our permanent collection that is essentially owned by the people of Kilkenny, and also provide a home for the Tony O'Malley estate, a really important aspect to our collections. The Butler Gallery has had a nice long relationship now with Cartoon Saloon, this four-time Oscar-nominated animation studios who are based here in Kilkenny. And it made a lot of sense for us to come together and make exhibitions.
I met a girl in the forest who has magic powers. When she sleeps, she turns into a wolf. She's a wolfwalker.
Wolfwalkers is our animated film, and it takes place during the Cromwellian invasion of Ireland. And it's about an English girl who comes over with her father, who's a hunter of wolves. His job is to wipe out the last pack of wolves in Ireland. And through a series of events, she becomes the thing that he is hunting.
The design of the exhibition encompasses two aspects of the film, which is the town's land, the town's people, and the forest area.
It reflects Robin's struggle as she tries to make sense of her life. In the town, she's oppressed and she's caged and she's trapped by all of the Puritan rules. So there's a very strong geometric patterning, lots of horizontals and verticals and very kind of dark black oppressive lines. And then in the forest, in contrast to that, it's very sketchy and free and loose, like watercolor painting underneath. And it's supposed to suggest this kind of life and energy that she doesn't have in the town. With Tom, myself, for Wolfwalkers, we wanted to explore how 2D drawn animation could take on maybe an expressive form of the art. So to express maybe the emotional turmoil of the characters through line art or through painting or through like a graphic representation. So it's much more focused on maybe visual language rather than the more realistic route of CG animation. So we're kind of using like, you know, line and color and mark making to be more expressive in our filmmaking.
It is an experience in itself to walk around the exhibition and to envelop yourself in the world of Wolfwalkers. So many beautiful drawings, working drawings of the wolves and the atmosphere.
I would encourage people to come to the exhibition. First of all, to support Butler Gallery and everything they do. They're non-profit and they really depend on like public coming in and supporting the exhibition. But also, this is quite unique in that it's like a public visual exhibition of artwork that is usually hidden away from the public. You know, normally an animated film during production and after production, the film is the thing that's out there for the public's release, but not the artwork that goes into making it. So this is a really unique chance for the public to actually get to see backgrounds, concepts, character designs in the flesh, you know, and especially in our studio, a lot of stuff is done on card and paper. So it's actual drawings of like early character designs, color, backgrounds, things that are normally tucked away and kept hidden in animation studios. So it's quite unique that way.
This feature is brought to you by Creative Ireland in partnership with RTE Supporting the Arts. Supporting artists, supporting us.
Yeah, so along with that, they also have now an annual festival called Kilkenny Animated, and this is all thanks to the work that Cartoon Saloon has done for this, in which they actually go out and decorate the town with the artwork that is done here, and there's a small clip of that that I can show.
What excites me most about Wolfwalkers is kind of what it means for Kilkenny to have a great kind of kids action movie actually set in Kilkenny about the history of Kilkenny, about the history of Ireland. It's just really great to be a part of something like that.
We made the film in Kilkenny, and the film is set in Kilkenny. So to be able to kind of have that here, and you go and see it in the cinema, and then you walk outside and you see the castle that was in the film. Like, it's incredible. Like, that's a once in a lifetime opportunity. So I'm so glad we got to do that.
I think it's important to do art installations like this because it's a kind of part of public engagement. You know, the thing is, to us, a film like Wolfwalkers it's been my whole world for the last 4 or 5 years, but the people of Kilkenny can actually be surprised to know that, oh, there's a film that's set here. And I think site-specific things like this really just catch people's eye. You can see people on the bridge just stopping, caught by it, taking pictures, and I think that's really powerful.
Like, the world is difficult and scary right now, but we always turn to art. We need art to get us through these times and to help us come together in these times.
I hope everyone watch the movie, and I hope they enjoy it. And please come visit Kilkenny because it's a lovely place. And if you have the chance to come next year to the Kilkenny Animated, it would be great. You will have loads of fun, and you would learn a little bit more of Kilkenny, a little bit more of animation, and it would be great to see you around.
In terms of cultural impact, this movie is also driving tourism for Kilkenny. So they probably use this in their promo for tourism. Well, coming to the end, again, I will go back to about the trilogy. They made these three movies. The reason that they have actually made 4 movies, and at some point in time, it was mentioned that they are a 4-time Oscar-nominated studio. The 4th movie is called Breadwinners, which is not related to this. So these 3 particular movies are related to the Irish folklore, and they explore our connection with nature, our connection with animals and flora and fauna around us. And that's the reason that this eventually became a trilogy, a triptych, which completes the whole story. Small tidbit, the first and the last movie are based in medieval and ancient times, whereas Song of the Sea is based in contemporary times. I don't know if it's something to do with human nature. Song of the Sea is actually their most popular movie. And I feel that this is because we relate more to stories that are in present times because we can see the connection. Although all three movies are hugely critically acclaimed, you know. So that's the end of my presentation. If you have any questions or anything you'd like to share, you're most welcome. Thank you so much for taking time to come and see the presentation. I hope it was entertaining for you. Thank you. Cheers.
I wanted to say that we have to thank the CSR also for the projector. Our projector today was disappeared.
Okay, so a thank you to CSR for sharing the projector with us.